Shelly Palmer is CEO of the Palmer Group and a professor of advanced media. He joins me now from New York. Shelly, great to have you with us.
Great to be here.
It seems like there's a bit of a coup happening in the AI space. Tell me about DeepSeek, what you know about it. I mean, it's a startup. It's 1 year old company. A lot of people are downloading it. And the question is it taking on the big guys in the United States?
So DeepSeek is a company out of China. It is a startup. As you said, it's about a year old. They have a model called DeepSeek V3. And in the last little bit, they released R1, which is a reasoning engine. And it's open source on an MIT license. You can download it. The magic here is that instead of taking months to train and hundreds of millions of dollars, it took under 2 months to train and cost under, according to the company, under $6 million to train. When you download it, you can post-train it, and pre-trained transformer models need to be post-trained in order to be valuable. And the compute cost is a fraction. We're talking a few percentage points fraction of what it costs to use the large language models from the big hyperscalers and foundational model builders like OpenAI or Anthropic. Or any of the other large foundational model builders. So this cost savings, along with the basically lightweight of the model, meaning you can download it and run it on a laptop, has sent kind of shivers through the spines, because what this really means is there's a possible future where algorithmic efficiency beats brute force computation. And the entire AI industry in the United States and around the world has been thinking about high-level computation and big data centers and a lot of energy use and chips. And now they're thinking, maybe not.
So it's a really good one to look at in terms of the numbers, because you're saying, and DeepSeek saying, that they spent just $5.6 million on this new AI model. Meta last week said it would spend upward of $65 billion. How come DeepSeek was able to crack this code and do it so much more efficiently, and the big guys in the U.S. unable to do so?
First of all, it's hard to speculate, but let's just say the following. There is a cliche that I believe is a cliche for a reason. There are more honors students in China than there are students in the United States. You're talking about a very deep pool of very smart people. That's thing one. Two, they've been restricted from getting all of the tools they need from the West, including specifically the kind of chips that would do the computation they need to do the advanced computation. This is a mathematical solution to a hardware problem. It's called algorithmic efficiency. They've actually written code that's more efficient than the code that's being used generally in the space throughout the world. So how did they do it? It's open source. You can see their research. They've been very good and transparent about publishing their research. They haven't exactly shown the secret sauce, but it is something that we'll be able to replicate. And by the way, the markets are reacting in a knee jerk, and most people don't understand any of what I'm about to say to you. No one in the United States, no American, no company anywhere on earth, to be fair, is going to lay down and die because a couple of engineers figured out a better algorithm. Math is math, and engineering is engineering, and these algorithmic efficiency approaches will be figured out worldwide. Now, what does that mean for NVIDIA's chip prices? What does that mean for nuclear power plants, for data centers? What does that mean for future data centers? The jury's still out. By the way, no one's replicated this. For all we know, this is the Sputnik moment, or this is the cyber Pearl Harbor, where they faked this whole thing, and it really wasn't done for $5.5 million in 2 months. We don't know. My guess is it was done for $6 million and was done in 2 months. That's my guess. And we're all going to have to rise to the challenge. And by the way, I am confident that everybody will.
Yeah, this is the thing. We were talking about the race, the AI race, and I think this is pretty much indicative of the race that has truly just begun. As you say, you can crack this code. If it's a mathematical solution, then you've got people that could work on it. But you touched on something in terms of the hardware and the GPUs and NVIDIA and so forth, and even what it means for electricity consumption for data centers. If what we're hearing from DeepSeek is, in fact, all factual, what does it actually mean? Does this change the calculation completely for AI?
So at the moment, it is much, much less expensive to run DeepSeek R1 locally than it is to, or even in the cloud, than it is to run any of the other models. So the question is not, is this better or worse? The question is, going forward, is algorithmic efficiency, this ability to run smaller models more efficiently, going to be a better path forward than the brute force massive compute models that we've used so far at OpenAI and Anthropic and at Google Gemini and at Llama, for Meta's Llama? We don't know the answer to that. Right now, it points towards two futures. One future is algorithmic efficiency. The other is brute force compute. There's no one in the world who can answer this question right now. It's all speculation. Time will tell. And as you've just said, it's very early days, which is like the beginning of the race. We're nowhere near the end of this race. We've never seen anything come this quickly. We've never seen exponential improvement that has really hit us at this speed. So it's accelerating, and we're going to all learn together. That's just the way it's going to go. And the markets are going to follow along because markets do that.
Well, speaking of markets, let's check in on the markets, because pre-market trade looked like a total bloodbath. And frankly, we're firmly in the red, and you've got all those tech stocks that are taking a huge knock. You've got the NASDAQ down over 3%, S&P down 2%, Dow down a third of a percent. And here's my thing. You understand, like many other people in the tech world, that geopolitics is firmly entrenched in all of this. President Trump was talking about huge investments in data centers. You know, it kind of shook things up, and everyone was saying it's a lot of money. Do these guys even have money? Elon Musk was asking the question. What do you make of this race? Because it's not just a global race. It's a big confrontation between the United States and China.
I think that's probably a mischaracterization of what's happening here. The science is progressing at a rate that we have literally never experienced. Every morning there's a new white paper from somewhere, from someone, about how to do everything more efficiently. We're moving from task-based models, where you give the model a task and it gives you an answer, to what's known as agentic models, which is a fancy word for agency. Here, instead of getting a single task done, you give the model a goal. Make me a travel reservation, figure out a problem, answer this full question completely. And so we're in this transitional period. Nobody knows whether it's going to take a ton of compute power or whether you can do this with a model like DeepSeek, where you get this immense algorithmic efficiency and cost efficiency, probably some combination of both. And by the way, you've got the chief scientist at Meta, Jan LeCun, saying this is not the way to do it at all, that we need a completely different approach called world modeling, worldview modeling. And that's also being considered. So for someone, the markets are going to react to just what they've done today. They're going to look at the stimulus and the information that they have, and they're going to react as markets react. But I wouldn't take this as any indication of the future, because no one making a financial decision here at the level of a market, the complexity of a market, is deeply understanding the future of AI any more than the people in it. It's very early days. And it's to make a projection about how this is going to go now, oh, we're not going to need data centers anymore. That's ridiculous. It's like a ridiculous concept. Oh, this is going to completely take over and we're never going to go back to big compute again. Stop it. It's not true. We don't know what the future is. It's probably some combination of both approaches, because that's what historically has been the case.
As you say, big speculation right now. Hopefully things settle. Shelly Palmer, great to have you with us. Thank you so much. You're-